So I'm going to speak about the institution of money and mainly how the state has taken over money in history and how it's very difficult to get rid of it, not only because of political reasons, but also because it's a very special institution and a very difficult one, and one that has huge effects. Can you hear me? Yeah? And one that has huge effects on the real economy. And so it's, in a way, explosive. Well, money emerged in the dawn of time. It's a custom. It's something that emerged like language or law. Governments think they can control language, law, and they can control money. When I was at the Bank of Spain, I was in the research department, and I was a historian of the Bank of Spain, and I deeply felt the contradiction that money seemed to be the one thing that could not be left to the market. And everybody told me that. And when we've had the financial crisis recently, again, money is a defect of the market. The market doesn't work in money, and if you let money be ruled by laissez-faire, you're in trouble. And that was the idea. So money was an affair of the state, I was told there. And the bank, Bank of Spain, would obviously manage the peseta, which was our currency then, with care and wisdom. Only politicians always interfered. But we could do it, and we were sure. And I felt very unhappy about that. And then went back to the London School of Economics to get a master in economics, and there I heard different stories, especially when I read and met Hayek. So money has emerged in the dawn of time. As I said before, it's like language and law. Language is not ruled by anyone, as I said to Corinne, except in France, where you have a French academy that tells you how to spell and what words to use. And as for law, we have this idea that law is really acts of parliament passed by whatever house it is, and not discovered. And when you look at society, most of the rules we have haven't been decided by anybody, they just happen. And I think that money is something like that. When it is well conceived, Hayek said in The Road to Serfdom, money is a fundamental institution of markets and individual freedom. Actually, he added, which is really shocking for many people, it is one of the greatest instruments of freedom ever invented by man, especially if it's anonymous money and nobody knows where you got it, what you're going to use it for. So, on what instinct, on what impulse is the use of money built? And Adam Smith said that we have, by our nature, a disposition to truck, barter, and exchange. He said that in 1776 in the Wealth of Nations. And he explained the mechanism of exchange based on self-interest. You want to truck, barter, and exchange, and we don't get our dinner, it is not from the benevolence of the butcher, the brewer, or the baker that we expect our daily dinner, but from their regard to their own interest. And so this is the main impulse in the emergence of money. Now, who invented money? Obviously nobody. That's very strange for us who use these banknotes. I can't read them on the shekel. On the euro, they simply say this is 10 euros. But on the pound note, the governor writes, "I promise to pay the bearer 10 pounds." So if you go there, you change the 10 pounds to 5 pounds, and that's it. But this comes from the time when you had the gold standard. This was a promise to give you gold if you took the banknote, and vice versa. But it's still there. So this, on the British pound note, indicates that it isn't the state
that's in, who invented money. Something else that emerged. And Karl Menger wrote a very important article in 1892 saying how the entrepreneurs create money. So if there's a good in society which is accepted by everyone because they know that then if they want to pay with it, they will be, it will be accepted by other people, then that good has an advantage. It has the advantage that you can pay less of it for the things you buy because it's convenient. And the other way too, you are ready to receive this money because you know you can pass it on. So the entrepreneur will discover which of these goods are the ones that people will accept more readily. And that entrepreneur wants something or discovers that there's some good that is safe, divisible, portable, and then he gets a better price and a profit. The entrepreneur, the intermediate, the speculator or whatever, gets a profit from having discovered that he can use money in this way. So money is a custom. Money is an institution based on weak unanimity. This is very important because people think that the market and money and so on is a place where you grab what the others have and unfairly. But unanimity can be everybody voting yes, but also unanimity, weak unanimity, is two voting yes and the others abstaining. So when I buy a house from you and I give you the money and you give me the house, the rest look on, unless they are worried about inequality, they look on and they allow us to do this. So it's weak unanimity. The market and money are institutions that everybody's agreeing on. And this is very important to see, to understand that. It reduces transaction costs, facilitates exchanges, measures prices, and ensures against future imbalances. We'll see these functions of money in a second. You don't exchange equal values. So I will say we measure prices, but not values, because the value of my money for you is greater than your house, and the money, the house that you give me is greater than the money. That's why we're exchanging. If it was equal value, we wouldn't try. So money is, in market in general, and money in particular, a part of a cooperative game where the dealer makes a profit. Good for them. And if you see that, then you see the market and money in a very different light. The three functions of money, many of you will have heard or studied this. Money is better than barter, and exchanging foreign transactions also allows you to move around the world. But you have the following functions. You measure and compare prices, not values, because the values are different. It stores purchasing power. Not only it's good for exchange, for measuring prices, but it stores purchasing power. And this was in Adam Smith. Adam Smith thought that money was a factor of production, because I can easily say, well, I know that in a month Elijah will pay me this and that, and then I can use it to pay the rent of my house. But suddenly Elijah disappears. So I don't have the income to be able to use it in the transaction. And so I need to have a till with cash in it, just in case things don't tally. Just in case, and for companies this is very important, they have to have a minimum of liquidity so as to face unexpected happenings in the market. So, for these functions to be carried out, you need money to be safe and according to a standard. The value of money, VM, is the inverse of the price level. When the prices go up, the value of money falls, and vice versa. So It's very important what money does to prices. If you issue too much money, then your prices go up, and the money that you have next day is worth less. So it's the institutional money, when it was embodied in coins, the state had only one function, or the kings, the function of guaranteeing content and fineness. And if you see a metal coin, not only is it stamped so that nobody can rob it, and also the side of the coins, at least in my in Europe, you have stripes so that nobody can sort of file it, and have these files, put them in a, as we had yesterday with the cheese, put them there and get some gold or silver unfairly. So that's what the government did. But the value of the coin was nearly, was a little more than the value of the metal in it. So governments soon started abusing the function by giving false guarantee, the guarantee that yes, this coin you have has so much metal, and the metal is no mixture in it. This is silver, I promise you, no copper, no copper in it, and so on. And this is what governments did so often. Now here we have a Spanish friar. He lived until he was very old in those times. He lived, as one can see, 85, that's right, and he lost all his teeth. But still he was very highly respected, and he is one of those who discovered the quantity theory of money. So what he said in 1556 in the Manual of Confessors, as you know, in the Catholic religion, you can, if you sin, you can go to your confessor, confess the sin, and it's absolved, and you avoid, eventually you avoid hell or purgatory or whatever. So there was a problem that with all the gold and silver coming from the Indies, as we call them, or from America today, the prices in Spain started going up. So he said, if somebody comes to sell, to tell you that he bought a house for 100 gold coins, and now he's selling it for 110, he may not be unfairly getting a profit, it's because prices have gone up. And so what he said is, when you have money coming from abroad into the system, the value of goods enhance exchanges with the arrival of the precious metal. Changes with the arrival of the precious metals. And the same with the rate of exchange. When these galleys from the Indies came with the gold and silver, mainly silver, they arrived in Seville, where there was a big monopoly. They arrived in Seville, and obviously prices in Seville were very high. And since the people in Seville had to use a bill of exchange to buy good cloth and other things to send over to America, then they had to say to their correspondent in Antwerp, now look, send me these lace or whatever, and I'll pay you so much silver. But the silver in Antwerp was of much higher value because there was little of it. So they had to take into account the rate of exchange depended on the relative supplies of money in one place and another, and he discovered that. Now, money supply tells also, as I say, on the rate of exchange, I told you about the bills. Now, there were a number of financial innovations, and this again is the story of money being an affair of custom, nobody designing it, and people trying to save on it, because money is expensive, and you have to bring it from all over the place. It's from the other side of the ocean in those tiny boats, and those terrible English and French pirates were just waiting there to get it for free after killing the whole or enslaving the sailors. And so you wanted to save on it. And to save on it, you had these institutions in fairs. Now, a bank is a bank, a bench. And in France they call it in the fairs of Champagne, une banque, and it's un banco in Italian and in Spanish. because you had all sorts of different currencies going around. And so these people put the currencies in little heaps and saying, this is the French currency, this is the Spanish currency, and they'll give you a rate of exchange to it. And that's why they called it banks. But also they did something else, which was, apart from the bills of exchange that I told you, they did something else, which was, if you were at a fair and you had just got a bag of silver coins because you sold three or four cows, you didn't want to go around with the coins, so you left it with the banker, and the banker gave you a chitty. I owe you this amount. And you could use that instead of going back to the bank and taking the silver and so on, making another purchase. You could use the chitty because people trusted the different bankers. Well, the bankers in the end, especially in Spain, but also in other places, lent too much to the government. And we know what that means. In the end, they went broke, most of them. Now, one of the inventions is a fractional reserve system. You must have heard of it. It means that the banker relends some of the deposits. Gets the deposit, promises to repay, as the Bank of England does. I promise to pay £10 to the bearer. Promises to repay, but he hopes or knows that not everybody will come to retrieve this deposit, and therefore relend it. And we know that then commercial banks create money. They create money by multiplying the amount they have in silver or cash, or by multiplying the amount they get lent by the central bank. And we have this relation that if you have to keep a reserve of 10% of the deposits, then the amount of money you can create is multiplied to 100. So you create $90 or 90 whatever if you're a commercial bank. And that's how commercial banks create money, and that's why deposits are part of money. And they're created, so then they lend it and they give credit, they open an account for you, and so it goes on and on, depending on how much you have to set aside just in case people come and try to get it for you. This is called the money multiplier. It used to be a reserve which was prudent, but then it's a required reserve today by law. The central bank tells you how much the commercial banks have to keep. 2%, no more. 2% is what they have as in reserve against all the money they create. 2%, 2.5%. And of course, then there might be trouble, because with only 2% reserves, and there's a crisis, everybody wants to bring out their cash, because they don't have any confidence in the paper money that is issued by the different banks, the IOUs. So what happens then? As we should see, commercial banks club together and have a central bank, spontaneously, a central bank which will be the lender of last resort. The central bank, if banks are in trouble, they will lend to those banks at a punitive interest rate so that they are not broke. Because sometimes, and the banking business is a difficult one, because you invest long term and you owe short term. And so you may have a very good balance sheet, but not liquidity. And if you don't have enough liquidity, then you may go broke without reason. Because in fact, you're a very good bank. So there emerges a central bank, the head of the club, ready to lend at a punitive rate, and also the bankers give that central bank the right to inspect, so that there's no free rider in the system, so that every bank behaves, because the others have a great interest in there not being a financial crisis. So this is how central banks emerge. Now, this is a very different story from the one I got at the Bank of Spain. The Bank of Spain was a creation of law. It was the government looking for us and so on. But nobody told me that central banks are very natural and that you need them if you have this system of re-lending what people deposit with you. So banks, central banks started to appear, back the water budget in Lombard Street, the wonderful book of 1873, spoke of the lender of last resort, precisely that. Water budget, by the way, was the founder of The Economist magazine. It's a very old magazine there. And then you had banks coming up. The Bank of Amsterdam was organized by the city of Amsterdam so that you could deposit with them the gold that you had, and they counted the gold that you gave them as if it were good, clean coins, not rocks, not old, and so on. And they gave you a chitty, an IOU, and that was used in Amsterdam. But this was not the state. It was a municipality, and it worked very well. But then government started needing money, debt. And so usually your central banks are born because the government says, I'll give you monopoly if you lend me some money. And this is what happened with Bank of England. A huge loan of 1,200,000 at 8%. That's a big rate. And against that, the bank was given the monopoly of issuing banknotes in a circle of 50 miles around London. And it didn't go bad because of the rules that we had for central banks while there was a good standard. But they allowed the bank to be limited liability because other banks in other cases had full liability. If you were a shareholder, the bank went bust, you lost everything you had there. But they gave them limited liability and the monopoly of the issued note. And this is exactly what happened with the Bank of Spain. An arch liberal, a lover of the market, was the Minister of Finance in 1869, and his government needed money, so he gave the privilege to the bank. And he ruled it ever since, because it went against his convictions. But there you are, that's politics for you. Now, money has been nationalized. It's been taken, grabbed by the state. And they've done such a good propaganda of it that we all think it's money. What would we do? How could we have money without the state? How could we have any confidence in it? My goodness, can we have confidence on the money that we have after what happened in 2007 and 2008? Of course, it was all the fault of laissez-faire. It's because, not because the banking authorities and the political authorities did a bad job. No. It's all this greed that people have, and then you make films, and you, greedy, make a lot of money with those films. Anyhow, so you nationalize money. From the beginning, the power to coin was a part of kingship, and it was simply a guarantee. But then that guarantee was abused by having bad coins. There was the malpractice of debasement. You added to the silver in the coin, you added other metals such as copper. And then you, in Castile, you had copper and silver. In fact, what happened is that the market again worked here because the Spanish silver coin became a world currency. And it was used in China, it was used all over the place. And so the silver coin was not touched, it wasn't debased, because it was important to get the income from issuing silver coins, which we'll see now, get it steady. But the money for the people in Castile, that was debased. And in the end, it became all copper and too much. And so you have, if you want to debase, and if you are a world currency issuer, you usually tend to keep your world currency steady. Not the Americans, not the dollar. That's for the reason that there's no standard there. But in times, you have these two this parallel money systems whereby you got the premium that I'll tell you about. So the power of coining was something that the state misused to be able to, for a time, to issue money that was undervalued, people didn't know, and so they give you the goods at the previous rate. But legal tender today is exactly that. The state says you can only, and courts say you can only undo the loan or return the loan that you got, and the lender should accept it by law because this is a national currency and this is legal tender. So it's a way of pushing you in the same way that they did when they debased the currency. Again, legal tender is presented as another thing. It's a good service that the state gives us so that we know that if we have the national money, we can pay our debts, etc. But in fact, it's exactly the same as it was with debasement. Now, why are states wanting, why do they want to issue money? And why do they want to issue gold money or silver money and then paper money? Why? And this is seigniorage. Seigniorage is the difference between the face value of money and its purchasing power. And when these were silver coins, gold coins, the difference between the face value and the metal in it was very small. It was simply a payment for the guarantee that the silver was at its finest and it weighed so much. So if you're an issuer of currency, and many people use it, you get huge seigniorage, especially if it's paper. Because if you look at paper, a 500 euro note doesn't cost 500 euro to print, certainly. So if people accept it, the Central Bank of Europe gets good seigniorage. And therefore, that's why they want to issue this currency so that people use it, and you have legal tender, that people use it. But also, there's a danger. That there's a limit to the amount you can issue to get seniorage. Because if you overissue, then prices go up and the value of money goes down. And so there's an optimal point of robbery. Up to point, but if you go too far, then people notice and therefore don't accept your notes anymore. I've seen the Zimbabwe notes for 5 trillion. Zimbabwe shillings and so on. In the end, nobody wanted it, and they moved over to the dollar, to the American dollar, which comparatively behaves a little better than the Zimbabwe dollar. So, so it's the difference between the face value and the value of the metal inside that gives you the seigniorage. So people tended to think that the value of money was because it was backed by metal. No, the value of money is kept up by reducing or by controlling issue, by controlling the creation of money. And having metal in it, because metal is difficult to get from mines and so to bring it over from South Africa or from California or wherever it was in the 19th century, when you have the gold or silver in the currency is a break, is a control, because you cannot issue so many of these coins because you don't have enough silver. So the value of money is due to this scarcity, not to what is backing it. And so here we will see with central banks what kind of rules they should obey, so the scarcity rule is not for gold. So imagine when money is not made of precious metal or an electronic entry, you could go on and on printing it, but there comes the hand that whips you because your prices go up and then you're not at the optimal point. Fiat money, fiat in Latin means let it be done. And fiat money is the paper money and electronic money created by the state, issued by a central bank or a treasury, not linked to metal. So it's ideally limited by a rule, but often at the behest of government, and government do whatever they want. So fiat money and the price level are very important, because if you have issued too much fiat money, then your prices go up, you might get into a hyperinflation. I seem to remember there were some inflations here in Israel, a number of them. What?
Up to 400% per day.
That's nothing compared with other inflation. With Argentina, what?
Compared to Zimbabwe.
And when banknotes lose their convertibility to gold, what gives value to money? Not the backing of the metal, but the acceptance by the public, and therefore the public is the sovereign. Now, one of the things that Milton Friedman explained to us is that we people tend to keep in ready cash a fixed amount of our income, something like 10%, just to be able to tidy over whatever needs we may need. So if the central bank issues more money, people who sell or work will get a larger amount of these notes. They don't want them. They want only 10% of what they think is going to be their income, so they spend it. And if they spend the difference, prices go up. And that's the mechanism that we have. It's the, in this case, it's the law that fixes or determines our will, our decision, fixes or determines how much liquidity we want. Now, Keynes had a law about what people saved. If they were rich, they saved more, if they were poor, they saved less, which Milton Friedman showed was wrong. Yeah.
I want to ask, the amount of money in the US and in Israel has risen by, I think, more than 100% in the last few years, and there is almost no inflation, and the private consumption is not up. So how does the two things?
Yes, it's a surprise.
Yeah.
Inflation will come. It's a surprise, but when we'll see the quantity theory of money, we will see that there's something called velocity. So you have an amount of money, but if people are worried by the money they are getting and think it's not going to last, they spend it more quickly. And so you multiply the amount of money by the rate at which you spend, at which you receive the money. So the velocity in a crisis goes down. People want to keep money. They are scared that they won't get enough. They won't be able to work, they are unemployed or whatever. So velocity falls when there is a crisis. And we're still there. Banks are flush with money. Companies are flush with money. But they don't spend it, just in case. Keep it back. So we'll see the velocity there. As we've heard in these meetings, this is not engineering. This is not an engine of a car. In Alice in Wonderland, the Queen of Hearts told Alice to play croquet. It's a peculiar game, full of vicious feelings. But she was given a flamingo, put it by the legs, and had to hit the ball with the head of the flamingo. And then the ball was a porcupine. And so when she tried to hit, the porcupine ran away, and the flamingo took its head in. This is exactly what happens with money in society. We decide. The government diddle us, they tell us things about it, but in the end we discover. And then, of course, we don't like the money we get. We'll see about the about velocity. Ah, here we are. This is Pitt the Younger trying to get money from the old lady, the Bank of England. And she's calling, she's saying, rape, crime, and so on. Is taking my gold, because Pitt suspended the convertibility of the pound from 1798 to 1821. It was suspended, and therefore they printed money. But people knew that if you printed money, the government could take the gold from you, and this is what happens. It's a lovely picture. The old lady seems not to be very attractive, but I think she at least her pockets are. Now, the quantity theory, which is one of, we have the first thing, which is a law or society, that we decide how much liquidity we keep, whatever the government says. And the other one is the effect of that, what an excess or the issue of money, which we don't want to keep, has on prices. So the quantity theory of money, we had Aspilqueta and Baudin formulated algebraically. The quantity of money is best understood as MB equal PQ, which is the quantity of money multiplied by the velocity of income is equal to price the price level multiplied by the amount of goods produced. Now, this is one of the difficulties that central bankers have and governments have, because if you increase the quantity of money, velocity may increase more rapidly, and then you have more inflation than the quantity of money explains. And then we don't know, and Milton used to say that very often, we don't know if we increase M, how much goes into prices and how much goes into quantity. Quantity means that if people start receiving more money, for example, next year, when I hope I may be able to come, I'll be told if there's an inflation, they'll increase my wage. I say, oh, I'm a wonderful speaker. They're paying me more. And therefore, I'll give four lectures instead of three. But then I discover it's inflation, and I'm getting the same amount of money that I did last year, and even less, depending on the rate of inflation. So we don't know when you increase the quantity of money, whether it'll go into production or it'll go into prices. In the end, it goes into prices. While we don't know, it goes into production. So it's a matter of short-term, long-term. In long-term, money goes into prices, that's that. So, reformulated by Irving Fisher, it was the price level is equal to quantity of money multiplied by velocity and divided by production. So if you produce a lot, then an increase in the quantity of money will not cause your inflation to go so quickly up. Ah, Milton Friedman's number plate. What do you have there? MV equal PQ. I'm so proud to discover this. on the internet. It's a lovely one. He knew how to put across simply, the stuff simply, and really make a difference. He didn't cut corners. It was true. He never lied, never made up things, but he was able to put them simply. So in Spain, we cannot choose our number plate. I don't know if you can in Israel, but you couldn't have the same number plate, everybody. So still, we leave it to Milton. So Milton, how did Milton Friedman say about inflation? And this is another thing that you keep in your mind forever. Inflation is always and everywhere a monetary phenomenon in the sense that it can only be produced by a more rapid increase in the quantity of money than in output. Here you have it. Price level, M times V divided by Q. If you produce a lot, then prices go up more slowly. So this is the idea. When people say, oh, prices have gone up because oil's gone up, or prices have gone up because wages, all these trade unions are putting wages up, and therefore we, the Bank of Israel, nothing to do with inflation. No, it's the bloody workers who are unionized. And what they forget is that the quantity of money has an effect on the general price level, but a change in relative prices, for example wages, will not cause an inflation unless you validate it by printing more money. Because you increase wages, people get unemployed, so you try to print more money so that the wages don't cut your employment, but then you have these two different effects. Money, increase in money supply, times V, has an effect on the general price level, and an increase in a relative price level needn't have an effect on inflation, because you can simply keep the amount of money in the country as it was before. So you know, some prices go up and some prices go down below the level. I'm simplifying a bit, but I don't simplify as well as Milton Friedman does. Perhaps I'm cutting some corner there. Somebody asked me yesterday, what was he like? Charming. He was a wonderful man. Always a smile. Tiny man, very small, tiny wife. I remember in Tokyo at the Montparnasse Society, they danced the foxtrot beautifully. You could see it was a marvelous marriage. And people, Schultz used to say, people like to argue with Milton, especially when he's not there. He was deadly in discussion. Always a smile, beautifully courteous. Everybody lost their temper, and he simply went on saying what he thought was true. And it just, I seen him speak in an amphitheater full of students from Oxford, all lefties, and he just beat them all with this kind of smile. And you can see it on the films, the famous films that we heard yesterday, the one Free to Choose. Again, he's a charmer. Not, I was told yesterday, Gary Becker, another great friend of mine, who people were afraid of. You were afraid of Milton, but he smiled and made it all right. So, Milton Friedman, here we come to another point, which is the point of the exchange of money. You can have fixed exchange rates. For example, in the gold standard, you have a fixed exchange rate, one sovereign, £1 note, or you can have flexible exchange rate. Now, when people say truly that Friedman was in favor of flexible exchange rates, meaning letting the exchange rate float according to the market, they forgot the other part. He wanted to have a rule to limit the amount of money being printed, limited the growth to something like 2, 3, 4%. Which was the growth of the quantity produced. So it was a system whereby you kept the internal, the domestic price level stable, and what you had to do, what moved with the bumps in the road, what moved was the exchange rate. You can have it the other way. The other way is to keep the exchange rate fixed and have the car move and the people in it flexibly accept whatever comes from the world, for one reason, which is to avoid inflation. So Friedman, yes, defended flexible exchange rate, but he had a rule for how much money you should print, and gold bucks go the other way around. So in one case, it's keeping the internal price level fixed. In the other case, it's keeping the exchange rate fixed. It's easier to keep the domestic price fixed because of politics and trade union pressure and so on. Having a gold standard is very good in the end, but it makes you suffer whenever there's some crisis or something. So Hong Kong has a fixed exchange rate with the dollar, 7.8 Hong Kong dollars to the American dollar. And they kept it. And there's no central bank. And you simply have a monetary authority that tells the private banks that issue the money, HSBC, to watch the rate of exchange. They cannot go out of the tram rails. So if Hong Kong gets too many American dollars, that makes the exchange go up, and you have to keep it there between the tram rails. But of course, to be able to have that kind of fixed exchange rate, then you have to have a very special society. The no budget deficit at all. Because the budget deficit tells people who, as we heard last night, surprisingly, people are not silly. And tells people, if you have a huge budget deficit, they'll print money. And so you discount the budget deficit. So no budget deficit. The balance of payments must converge to zero. Not having, when I hear people say, oh, the country is going well because we have this surplus on the balance of payment, which means that you sell things abroad for bits of paper. And, well, you could do something better than that. So the idea is that one year with another, the balance of payments is in equilibrium. And then you have a currency board. As you've tried, you have a number of countries that have a currency board, which simply means I will give you 7.8 Hong Kong dollars for each US dollar, and vice versa. You have that in Panama, and you have that in Ecuador. By the way, in Ecuador they have a very left-wing government, but the president is always asking to have flexible exchange rates without another rule, always. And the fact that it's on the dollar standard stops the president of Ecuador from doing many same things as they did in Venezuela, around the corner. So, in the case of Greece, and I think I sent you an essay I wrote on the case of Greece. If you are on a fixed exchange rate, as Greece is on the euro, you to have money in the country, you can't print it. So you have to have money coming in from your surplus in the balance of payments. And if you are a very bad economy and can't set anything abroad, then suddenly you don't have any money left. Crazy winters, I mean, the notes. You can't use the credit cards. And what happens? The retirees can't get their pension. This is a photo from Athens. He'd gone around so many cash tills, wasn't able to get money. There is his old age pension little booklet, and he sat down and cried because he couldn't take any money for his family. And this is what happens when you have a gold standard or a dollar standard. There's a limit to what the government can do, and that's why some of us, think there should be that kind of standard, because it's a very harsh limit. And here you see, of course, the European Union came and gave them money. And they've been discussing ever since what they should do to right their economy. Because there's a rule in the European Union which is no bailouts, as you have in America, but then you bail them out. And that's what the way they've done it with Greece. So how to control central banks? We have with Milton Friedman, we have this flexible exchange rate, but we don't want too much money to be printed more than production. You could even say that you could keep the money stable and have prices fall. There's this idea that deflation is bad for you. Every central bank is saying, no, we want to bring the inflation up to 2%. We can't have this zero inflation. What do you mean you can't have this zero inflation? Deflation is bad when people wait for the next fall in prices. And that can suck you down. But if it's simply that the country is more productive, why shouldn't prices fall, as they did from 1870 the prices fell because the economies were more productive. And so there's nothing wrong with that, and so you could change the Milton Friedman rule a bit. How to control central? The gold standard. It was defined by Newton. Hume and Adam Smith on money disagreed. Hume didn't trust the banknotes. Adam Smith said banknotes save on the metal, and metal is very expensive, especially in those times. So they disagreed on that. But the Bank of England had a note issue gold window. So you could go to the window, take them the pound sterling, and you would get the coins and vice versa. And that kept the price more or less stable. And they had other institutions to make it stable. It was suspended, as I said, from 1798 to 1819, and then during the First World War, and it ended in 1932. Sometimes some institutions try to have two different monies, and in the Latin Monetary Union you had silver and gold, but it's very difficult because the price of silver and gold on the market change, the relative prices. And so suddenly all silver disappears because it's valued at one coin of gold, 16 or 15.6 coins of silver, and if silver becomes more valued, you take all the gold to the bank and get the silver out, and vice versa. So it's very difficult to have a bimetallic system. And the gold standard was generally used in Europe from 1871. The German Empire got a huge compensation for the French attacking them in the War of 1870. It was the Germans who attacked them, but they were able, Bismarck was able to hide that, and with that they went onto the gold standard. Now, this is dramatic. It really is. Oscar Wilde, in The Importance of Being Earnest, has Miss Prism teach a young unwed girl. And she's teaching her political economy. And when they came to the chapter of the Turkish piazza, Miss Prism said, "This is too exciting a subject for an unmarried lady, so we'll drop it." This is too exciting. Because I don't know if one can see, yes you can, the yellow you can't see very well. The yellow is Germany, the United States is the green one, Britain is the black one, and so on. So you see how it was during the time. During the time of the gold standard, at the beginning of the 19th century, money was valued as at the beginning of the beginning of 20th century, valued the same as the beginning of the 19th century. This is really, really incredible. To have this. Well, this is the Napoleonic Wars, when the conversion was suspended, and then it went down like that, and in fact, prices are falling, as you can see. Agriculturists complained in the US and said we don't want gold, we want silver. And then somebody wrote the Wizard of Oz. The Wizard of Oz is a criticism of the gold standard, because the wizard is not there. It's huge and so on, but when you look out behind it, there's nothing there. And so the Wizard of Oz was saying, we don't want the gold standard, we want prices to go up for us, for what we sell, and this fetish of gold is as silly as what is shown in my book and film and so on. Well, this is what we live with. And it can't be good. Of course, if you have inflation for the time, as David Hume used to say, it makes the wheels go around more quickly, because people don't notice the inflation is coming, but in the end we pay for it. And we pay for it in prices going up and in financial crisis. And so there's a huge financial crisis. And you see, that is 1920, and it kept on. We have the huge financial crisis in 1932, and again we've had one now. And so when people tell me, yeah, of course, the state must look after money. Well, thank you very much. It just doesn't function. There are monetary systems that function well. Yes?
I want to ask, what happened in 1913 except World War I that can explain this?
World War I.
That's it.
All went off the gold standard. Same time. And printed money, because World War I was mainly financial money, and World War II, World War I was mainly financial taxes and money, and World War II was financed on debt, especially in Britain. So that was it. So here we have two views of what a central bank can do. One is fine duty. You change the amount of money without telling many people. The amount of money so that you keep unemployment low, unemployment high. In fact, the Fed, Federal Reserve Board, has a double goal. Keep the value of money and keep unemployment low. And these, in the short term, are incompatible. And so you have these banks looking at whether there's going to be unemployment or a crisis, and then you push money in. Greenspan did that in 2001, and from 2001 to 2007, you had money being pumped in so as to avoid crisis. Now, capitalism has crisis, and that's, we heard it when people spoke about Schumpeter. You have new inventions, and that makes old modes of production obsolete, and therefore, you have a crisis while the thing shifts. Now, to try and avoid crisis all the time, and this is something that Hayek and others in the Austrian school said, if you try to avoid that, in the end, you overinvest and then you have a crisis. And therefore, what fine-tuning bank, these clever people who don't tell you but they move the thing, they increased the interest rate, they reduced the interest rate, and then suddenly they put the interest rate at zero and nothing happens. Because people learn and people don't trust the money they get. And they don't think the interest rate is going to stay that low, except some people take mortgages and they know what they're doing. So you need rules to keep the value of money steady. And there are different rules around for national central banks. Inflation targeting, which means you promise that you keep inflation at 2%, take measures to reduce it to 2% if it goes over it and under it. Then the Taylor rule is a rule by John Taylor, who says you ought to pay attention to what is called the output gap, that is the difference between production in a country and what is the trend, and you also pay another half attention of the quantity of money. You have a currency board, I told you about currency boards, you have the gold standard, and you could have monetary competition, which we already have. Central banks are an oligopoly, and we know from oligopolies that they sometimes keep by the rules and try to cheat without anybody else noticing. So you have this oligopoly, sometimes there are exchange wars, sometimes they all agree not to have an exchange war. Because exchange wars are very bad. If you reduce the value of your currency by overprinting it, then other people can do it, and in the end it stops the economy from growing. So you could have monetary competition by private monies. And this is something I'm not going to say much about because I know very little about it. I don't know what Bitcoin is going to give and the others. I don't know, maybe it'll work, maybe people will take it. With Bitcoin, it's a very strange thing that to have a currency, you have to be sure that other people will accept it. Now, if it's a new currency, there's a barrier to entry. But Bitcoin seems to be getting over that barrier. I don't know. Here we have, Hayek proposed the denationalization of money in 1976. Everybody laughed. How can you have denationalized your money? This was, in fact, an investment plan. Let's have a private bank that issues safe money, and then people will use it. There's this barrier of entry for entry, which makes it difficult. But in the case, you have Hayek saying that in 1976, and he was pointing in the right direction, I think. Bitcoin and other currencies, other monies, well, query. But you can read Kevin Dowd, New Private Money, a bit far player, is a very good summary of all the private monies that there are and what happens, and our government is trying to stop it. You see, you have to be transparent about how you get your money and how you use it, because it's good for you. It's good for the country. And so whenever there's secrecy, and in fact, banknotes are secret, because you spend them, nobody knows. Whenever there's secrecy, then terrorists will get the money, or it'll be drug dealers that get the money. And to stop those bad things, we want to know what every one of you spends and where you get your money. And in fact, legal tender's gone out of the window, because you cannot put in your bank account a 500 euro note without saying who you are and why you got it. This is the government trying to stop people from being free in the use of what is theirs. So have a look at Kevin Dowd, and if you are interested in this, and I hope I have half convinced you that money is not a creation of a state, not a creation of bank or central state central banks. It's a custom, it's a habit that grows, and the fact that the state meddles with it is making our life miserable. Thank you. Any questions? Yes?
There is an England movement that called positive money. In the United States, they have Occupy Wall Street, and even here in Israel, we have the movement for a monetary change. And their claim is that we need to go for a full reserve banking system, because when the banks actually made money out of air, they're making the economics very fragile, and they claim that in the last few decades, all the financial crises actually the reason of that banking system, and I want to hear your opinion about it.
Now, two questions here. One, whether it's a bad idea to have commercial banks create money. That's one. And the other one is whether bankers and greedy bankers are to blame for everything. So the two things are put together. Now, there are a number of people in our confraternity who are in favor of having full reserves for banking, so that banks don't lend any money. They become cash coffers. You put your money in. In fact, you pay the bank to keep your money. And then all the loans come from investment funds. And this is the case, more of the case in the US, where investment funds are important. In Europe and Japan and so on, banks are very important for financing companies. Now, I tend to think that if you get rid of bank money, of commercial bank money, you will not have enough credit, and credit will not be spread enough, because though you have angels for the kind of new companies that have grown here in Israel, still credit will not be spread unless you have a banking system that creates money and lends to other people. But many people disagree with you there. Among others, Phelps, the Nobel Prize, told me, let's all go to banks that keep your money and have investment funds. Do it. Then the second point is, if they had no banking money, we'd see what these people say. But anyhow, they say that. And then the second one is crony capitalism. It's true that there's been too much involvement of government and bankers in Wall Street and in London too. And therefore, more competition would be a good idea, and crony capitalism is a defect of our system. You have a question? Yeah.
What do you think of the return to the gold standard?
Well, I tend to be for it, but I know that it may be very difficult to institute it in modern society. Hong Kong has no union. They are forbidden. So you need, if you fix the exchange rate, you need a flexible domestic economy. If you fix the price level, you need to have a flexible exchange rate. So to be able to be on a currency board or the gold standard, then you need to be sure that you have an economy that's flexible in their prices and wages and ready to take unemployment when it comes. In Hong Kong, they take it on the chin. And if things go bad, they go bad for a little time, and then they creep up again. And this is the reason is that crisis, that is, real crisis, don't have to last too long. They last long because financial crises come in and make them last longer, or accumulate the force that then burst out. So Jerry Jordan has told me, I don't know about needing the gold standard. We need some standard. Some standard. Something that stops central banks from making the mischief they've been doing from 2001 to 2006. And also, you don't have the kind of legislation that you have in the US as to who the bank should lend them, give their mortgages. Latinos and colored people and so on in America, though banks knew very well, and the government too, knew very well that you couldn't rely on them paying their interest even because they didn't have a job, then that of course accumulates black clouds. But this was an idea of Roosevelt, who's one of the bugbears. Roosevelt in 1937 created Fannie Mae. And for a time, Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac and others worked well. Then there was a federal fund to lend people to have the American dream of owning your own home. I always wonder whether you should own your own home, perhaps you put your money somewhere else and invest it in different ways. And it's dangerous to own your own home because prices can fall through the floor. So I would tend to say that if we had the kind of society that takes the gold standard, it would be better. But democracy, we heard yesterday that democracy functions. It functions, but sometimes it takes a time to function. And therefore, perhaps Milton Friedman's view is better.
I want to ask you about too big to fail.
Sorry?
About too big to fail. I know you're opposed to bailouts, but it seems that in banking there is an increasing return to scale, so banks will be big and will be interconnected, and banks that go bankrupt will have systemic effects on the economy. So what should we do if we decide that we do not want to bail out banks? Is there something we should do to make this less dangerous?
Now we have a book which I have up in my room, you're reading it, by Kalomiris, what's the second name?
Haber.
Hey, Kalomiris and Haber. Say, it's called Fragile by Design. Say, comparing what the monetary system what is in Canada and what it is in the US. Same people really, same language, long border, and Canada only had systemic crisis in 1836 and 1839, and no more. And the US must have had 50 crises from that time, from 1837. So what Kalomiris and Haber say is that in Canada you have big banks, and they are overseen by the government very closely, so that they don't imprudently lend, and therefore it might be an idea to have a different monetary system as they have in Canada. I don't have the answer. And one of the good things of these seminars is that we don't have the answer, and you are all going to find it. So if you want to look at Fragile by Consent, I think you will have an argument for the government governing central banks and money, doing it in a way that allows banks to be very big and to have branches. They said in Canada that the whole point is to have branches, and when you have banks that are reduced to a state, then it's easier to have a financial crisis. So after you read that, you tell me and I'll be able to answer the question.
Thank you.
Yes.
So Pedro, could you perhaps talk a little bit about the euro and what that experience so far has taught us? Is it a success? Is it a failure? And what do we learn from this with regard to the nature of money?
The euro is a partially failed experiment for a number of reasons. And I was one among many who published in the Institute of Economic Affairs in London telling the British, don't join the euro, don't join the euro. The reason is that to be able to have a single currency, you either have to be very flexible, or the economy of the monetary zone has to be very similar. You can't have very poor countries and very rich countries if you have a single currency, unless the poor countries are ready to take it on the chin, as I said, in Hong Kong. So what we had there was a rule of zero public deficits when the euro was created, no bailouts of countries, and with those two rules, then countries would be careful not to overeat, not to have too large a budget deficit and start lending when they shouldn't. Now, the question was that the markets at the beginning of the euro believed in it. And so they charged the same interest rate to Spain and Portugal as to Germany. And so you had these very low interest rates in the south of Europe and Greece and so on, and those very low interest rates made for a bubble. There's theories about bubble, and I can say something more later. So then what these statists do is say, well, of course, look, we can't have a single currency without the central government. Because then the central government will look at the different banks and tell them what to do. And so they created the euro to foster European unity. Rather than to do it through competition and open markets, they said, if we impose a currency, then everybody will feel very European, and we will help the countries that are poorer to come up to another standard. And so the markets believed it, and for a time, interest rates were very low everywhere. But then what you had is that Greece lied with their statistics. We didn't know what the Greeks were doing, they didn't know what they were doing, and there was a failed tax system. You remember about taxes on swimming pools in Greece. I think there must have something like 120 people declared they had a swimming pool. And so that's the other thing that you need to have. If you have a fixed exchange rate, you need to have a flexible economy. And the economy in Europe is not flexible. So they put the cart before the horses by having, they try to force the economy to become competitive by imposing a single currency on it. And it just isn't working yet. And so the answer has been, we want central government, but since we can't get it now, we want inspection, we want regulation, and now central banks are regulated and private banks are regulated to an untold amount. So on the whole, it's an idea of Mandel's, who got the Nobel Prize for it. Idea of Mandel's that you need a stable, large currency with a very large monetary area. He gave the theory of optimal monetary zones. Well, obviously, Europe is not an optimal monetary zone. He didn't care. And so, in the end, what we've created is too soon a currency with not enough conditions that they should be, and heavy crisis because the European Union is a very restricted and regulated system. I don't know if it will fail. I think they'll do anything. It was Mr. Draghi who said, I'll do anything to save the euro. So, there'll be an inflation. Yes. Who has one question down here? Were you speaking now? Just now?
No, I was.
Somebody over there? No? Oh, you do.
I was wondering if you might be able to say a little something about negative interest rates. The ECB, the European Central Bank, now has negative interest rates. The Bank of Japan has negative interest rates. Can you tell us how these work in practice, and whether you think they're going to be effective in rescuing the economies of Europe and Japan? Should Israel have negative interest rates, for example?
Money is not an engine of growth. And therefore, giving lots of money doesn't guarantee that you will grow. Growth comes from new ideas, from entrepreneurship, from hard work, and so on. That's where, and good free trade, that's where growth comes. So if you don't want to free the economy, then you use currency, you use your money to try and make the country grow. So what we witnessed after the crisis is that people are accumulating, and firms are accumulating money. There's a fall in velocity, and therefore you push money into the economy, you take the horse to the trough, the horse won't drink, as Kate used to say. So what you have is you push money into the system, and it doesn't seem to work to revive the economies, because reviving the economies comes from another part, picking the low-hanging fruit of no regulation and so on. So what they are trying to do, what they do is they put the interest rates down, and then they lend money to commercial banks. And commercial banks put the money back into the central bank. And so now they are charging, the ECB is charging banks for putting the money, for depositing money with the ECB. So it's trying to make them lend at whatever price. Now, zero interest rates are very dangerous for the insurance industry, life insurance. You are guaranteeing something 50 years hence, and the life insurers don't make any money, or little money, because interest rates are so low, they can't place their investments so that they make some money, and so they tend to take more risk. And then banks, again, have a very small difference between what they charge for lending and what they get from their investment in interest rates. So again, banks are in trouble, not only because of competition, but because of zero interest rate. And so once you put your interest rate to zero, near zero, you want to get out of it. You want to bring the interest rate to a sensible level. And so you say, next quarter, we're going to put it up by half a point. Come next quarter, no putting up, as we have been fed. So it's very difficult to get out of zero interest rate without stopping growth completely for a time. I think it's been it's very easy. A pair of English tourists in Ireland, and they spoke to a gentleman who had some sheep there. He said, "How can we get to Tipperary?" "I wouldn't start from here." And this is exactly what's happened. How do you get back the interest rate? "I wouldn't start from here." So they got themselves in a pickle, I feel. And I don't know how they get you and get out of it. I don't know. It really is bad central bank policy. The belief, if you read the ECB, they say money only works to increase employment in the short run. But in practice, they don't believe that. And they're using money to try and revive the economy. And that's the center of the situation in which we find ourselves. More questions?
Another question?
Yeah. The central banks in Israel and also in China sells money, foreign money, dollars and euros, and trying to influence the currency, the currency's rate by it. What do you think about those steps?
Well, exchange wars are very bad because they tend to be replied by other people. And also because they are very bad for trade. They make one country export more, but then the others don't export as much, and it unbalances trade. Now, you can, as the Chinese have done, try to lower your prices constantly for a long time to increase your exports for a long time, by fixing too low an exchange rate. Makes the Americans angry, I should say quite rightly, because you should have a price in the market. And then what you have with too low an exchange rate is that all kinds of businesses profit, exports. And so you have the good ones and the bad ones go on exporting. Now China has found that there's a limit to what you can do by having the whole economy produce because they can sell abroad. And now they're moving for two reasons. One, that much of their production is inefficient. And secondly, that Vietnam has lower wages. So now they're getting the sort of medicine they were given. I think exchange wars are dangerous and you don't need them. It would be good to have standards, or if not, the Milton Friedman rule for everybody.